security to achieve that, we have some guidelines. So that is called the OWASP Top 10 Open Web Security Application Project. We know that due to the digitization of all the services, either they are the pension, passport, banks, railway reservation, they are now digitized. All the services are digitized. So what happens that most of the people are unable to access these services, and for that the reasons are the disabilities they have. They have motor disabilities, they have eyesight problem, or any other kind of disabilities. And those are childs below 10 years or below 8 years. They are also unable to access that because that may be due to the any reason. And those are the elder people above the 65. They may also feel the same kind of problems. They are not able to access the websites. They are unable for the reservations or to avail any kind of services like the PDS, public distribution services. They are not able to receive. So for this purpose, the government came with an idea that these services should be accessible to everyone. Either they are suffering from a disease or not suffering from disease, because after some time we will also face this problem. Now we are young, after 20 or 30 years we will also get us at the same stage. So to increase the coverage, the government came with the guideline. The earlier guideline was the GIGW 2010. Now these are the 2018. So these are the latest guidelines. We call them GIGW 2.0 as well. So it is divided into the two parts. First is related to the general guideline, and the second part is the accessibility guideline. General guidelines have guidelines for the how the website should be visible and the what the security aspects should that fulfill, so that the data you are entering or the data which is visible, it should be genuine. And these guidelines are adopted by the DARPG, that are Department of the Administrative Reform and Public Grievance. And these guidelines are also the part of the Central Secretariat Manual. So these guidelines are based on the four principles. These are the perceivable, operable, understandable, and the robust. The meaning of the perceivable is that the user must be able to perceive the information that is presented there, and it should not be invisible in all other senses. And this principle can be achieved when the non-text content is represented as a text equivalent, the color contrast which is displayed used in the website, that is properly managed, and the color is not used to convey the any information. Like if the someone has a color blindness and you are saying the please click on the red color to go for the registration, click on the blue color for the deregistration, click on the green color for the payment. So if the person is a color blindness, he cannot identify the color. So it means that it is violating the principle of the perceivable. And the second principle is operable. User must able to operate the interface, and the interface cannot require the interaction that the user cannot perform. Means all the things which are interface is providing, they are operable either by the keyboard or by the mouse we have. So it means it must not be any device like that. If you build a joystick, then you can use it. Most of the people don't have joystick in their laptop or in mobile. So the things should be operable. So the how it can be achieved, all functionality should be available via the keyboard, provide a mean to bypass the repetitive block of content. I will show you what is the meaning of this thing. For now, currently you can understand the for every website, whenever you will go at the first or second option, there is a option skip to the content. And later some buttons are there, home, payment, registration, number of academics, universities, and the main contents comes after that. So whenever the any person is accessing which don't have the eyes, wants to browse that website, that time he will, that the NVDA, which is the our tool that reads the content and loads that, and the based on that the user perform the action. Whenever every time he will visit a new page or the sub pages, then what will happen, the repetitive content will come again and again, and that is obviously not the useful. So the skip content is there, must be there, understandable. The user must able to understand the information as well as the operation of the user interface, and this can be achieved by the some way they are listed here. Like the first one is provide a way to determine the meaning of unusual words, easy to read and understand. The web page must be operated in predictable ways, and the enable user to easily determine the errors they have. And the fourth feature is the robustness. Meaning is that one website should be accessible in most of the browsers. Maybe it is not accessible, like any website is not accessible in the Tor browser, and the Tor browser is exception. But the website which you have created, like for your college you have a website, it should be accessible via Internet Explorer, Chrome, Mozilla, or the which is widely used in public. So it's for the robustness of the of your website you have designed. So the government comes with the guidelines, these guidelines for the website and the mobile as well, and these are divided into two parts, general and accessibility. Now just here I will just show you what is this general guideline. I will not read all these guidelines, but I will tell you some guidelines, something like the for the first there are 36 general guidelines for the website. What is the thing? Like the first guideline is web information should be present. Web information is a legal authority who will be responsible for all the contents are present on the websites. If anything is not present on the website, then the web information will be responsible for that. And web information is nominated by, web information is nominated by the director, by the vice chancellor, or any other person designated authority. He will responsible for the updates, he will responsible for the patches, security features, all the things he will be responsible. If any issue comes, legal issue comes in the future, then the only web information manager is responsible, nothing, no one else. So it, so this guidelines comes with the legal guidelines as well as, and there's some guidelines. The point number three, you can see that there must be copyright policies. Like that, if you have a special research you have published, so what should be things for that, you have a copyright for that or not, how the any person can use that, he can use it without your permission, he can use without your permission, that should be there. And what is the privacy policy terms and condition, what is monitoring plan, when you are updating the website, you are which section you are frequently updating, which section you are updating after 6 months or 1 week, and what are the security policies you have opted, and the source of content which you have taken. For point number four is saying the content which you have taken is these contents belongs to you? If it is belongs to you, that doesn't violate any guidelines. Nothing is extra required. But like you have published a research paper, like we have discovered a new medicine about the coronavirus or the new spikes of the coronavirus, and you have published that. No, this is not the right way. This is not the legal. This is not ethical. This is the purely malafide intention. You cannot publish that. If you are publishing that, there are two things. You have to take the permission from the owner, and the permission should be in the written thing. Home page should be update, should have the last update. Many websites don't have the point number six, ki when it is updated. Even if it is updated, then it will show ki, it is updated 6 months before. Even if it is not updated, it is shown that web page is updated. So things should be clearly and correct. Point number seven is saying that any file, any content you have on your websites, for that you should provide a title. What is the size? What is the format? Like you have given a audio files, but you have not placed that is the audio file. What is the size of that? Then what the problem will come? How the user will know that is the audio file? And what is the size of that? I may have a low internet connection, low bandwidth connection. I am not willing to download that. If you have a video of the 1 GB on your websites, and I don't know how, I have a limited only half GB of the data per day. Then if I will download it by mistakes, then all data will consume there. So the things should be there, and that's why these guidelines are made. And some guidelines are like that. All outdated relevant information should not be there. Archive should be created. Some national portal should be designed there for academics, like the UGC, AICTC, MHRD. These are the prominent portals should be present there. And Bihar government portal, they all should be mentioned there. And by seeing the website, point number 15 is saying that by seeing the website, we should be aware that from which state, from which country this website is belongs. Let consider you are in Australia and you are visiting a institute websites, and nowhere it is mentioned that it is belongs to India or it is belongs to USA. No national emblem is used, no logo is used. So this is a violation of the guideline. So I hope I am able to convey what is these guidelines are made. So these are the total 36 guidelines. In this guideline, security guidelines are also presented. That is the point number 23, 30, 31. It is saying the security audit should be there. So it is our the second part. Security audit can be done by the STQC or by the CERTIN impaneled agency. CERTIN is an autonomous organization of the Ministry of Electronics and IT. Anyone can go there. They have an impaneled list of about hundreds organizations or hundreds companies, private sector companies. Anyone, any customer can go there, because the STQC does not have a manpower, all the manpower that we can check all the websites all the times. So we have given the dead targets to the private sector also. And thus the website which we have implemented, that should be hosted, either government website should be hosted either on the NIC server or ISO 27001 certified. That certification guarantees that it does not violate the security guidelines, and it is provided some kind of unhackables. So these are the some guidelines, general guidelines. What the accessibility guidelines says, these are the 32 in number. This says that all non-text content should have alternative text. Web page does not have a content which flashes more than 3 seconds, because we cannot see that. If the content is flashing within 1 second 5 times, then even we cannot see that. How the this is from the perspective from all differently abled or not abled people. The caption or transcription should be provided for the pre-recorded video. Like when we open a video in the YouTube, the options come of the captions. So it is given. Why that the caption is given? It is given because of, if any person cannot hear, so at least he can read that and watch that and can understand what the speaker are saying in that. And this guideline is mandatory for the Hollywood movies. In Bollywood, this is not applicable right now. So somehow they are not aware or not concerned about the differently abled people. So it should be come. So these are 32 guidelines. So these are the some modes. There should be a sitemap, help, feedback section. Whenever you are filling a form, then the time should be there. It should not be like that, that if you are too fast for the in keyboard typing, then you can fill the form. Those persons are slow in typing, they cannot fill that form. So it violates that accessibility guideline, that we are not able to assess that. If you are, I hope it is clear from the example. You are willing to fill a form for the, you are applying for the gig, and the restriction is that you have to fill the form within 15 minutes. So it is 15 minutes is very short span for everyone. So they give the time about 45 minutes or 1 hour, so that we can easily fill that. Because many times in uploading the signature images, the problems arises. So these are the about the website guidelines. Web page should have a proper markup language, name and role. All interface component must be programmatically determined. This is the what this do. With this have that whichever tool we are using, NVDA and NVDA generally we use, that can read that loudly. If the structure that structure is not proper, then the tool will not work properly. So sometime it will read the heading, sometime it will go to the home section, then it will come to the bottom, then it will go to the right. So it is not the structured way. So whatever we are following, that should be structured way. For mobile also, they are the 4 general guidelines and accessibility guidelines. Somehow both are same. So I am just showing you what are the guidelines for the mobile app and what are the accessibility guidelines for the mobile. This features is implemented in the mobiles. Whenever you will go to the setting option and there is an option of accessibility, click on that, close your eyes and try to operate your mobile. Then you will find that how the person having a disability of a specific kind are accessing their smartphones. They are able to read all the things, perform all the tasks. So now, what are the legal provisions? What guidelines are available? Government has done a lot of efforts. But if there is no legal validity or legally they are not implemented, then it comes a legal challenges. So for this, the government have signed a United Nations General Assembly adopted right of convention person with disability in 2006, and India is a signatory for that. And they have come with the provision and they have implemented an act, right of person with a disability act 2016, and the number of disability in that increase. Earlier there was only seven disabilities, now the 21 disabilities are there. If anyone, any organizations, either government or private, is not following the accessibility guidelines or this act, then there is a provision of 2 year fine or two year imprisonment and up to 5 lakh rupees fine. ठीक है, यहाँ तक आई होप दिस इज क्लियर टू यू. व्हाट इज द गाइडलाइंस, व्हाट आर द लीगल प्रोविजंस आर देयर. द पार्ट वन इज कंप्लीट. नाउ वी आर कमिंग फॉर द पार्ट टू. व्हेनेवर वी आर कमिंग, व्हेनेवर एनी वेबसाइट कम टू फॉर अस, देन वी चेक ऑल दीज थिंग्स. इफ वी हैव फाइंड द सम कॉमन मिस्टेक्स व्हिच जनरली दे डू. द सम आर लाइक दैट वेब इंफॉर्मेशन इज नॉट प्रेजेंट, नो इंफॉर्मेशन अबाउट दैट. So if you are feeling a problem about you are willing to open a social justice department, MHRD website, whom you will contact. If the, let consider now recently this is in the news that the Chinese hackers have put number of DDoS attacks on the our financial markets. This they have uploaded some random videos on SBI websites. So whom you will contact, whom you will inform, this is our duty to inform that sir, there is a problem. If you have a district websites, district website is not so much frequently accessible by any person, hardly we visit them. If anything is put there, then whom you will inform? Or there is no mobile, no email address given. So for this, name is given, full address is given, telephone number is given, email address is given, all things are here. So this is the web information manager details should be present, and the headings which in the during the implementation we are using, six type of headlines are given, H1 to H6 are given by HTML or web 2.0, web 3.0. These headings should be used properly. Sometimes what we will do, we use these headings as a paragraph. Why? First it is come the heading H1, then H2 font is little smaller, H3 is little smaller, and H4 is also little smaller, so that H4 or H5 can be used as a font style. But it is not recommended, it is not a good idea to implement your website like that way. So the heading whenever you are using, that should be proper. This is a web accessibility tool. You can use that to judge any website is they are maintaining a proper proper things or not. This is return very quick results within 5 or 10 minutes. And this is the NPTEL website. You will I told you one guidelines that for every file whichever is present there, it should be mentioned that what kind of file that is, because lecture 6 lecture 1 introduction to blockchain download, it is given, it will automatically start the downloads, but you don't know what is that. It is written here, this is MP4, and the transcription is also provided there. You can see that, you can download that also. If you cannot hear, then you can read that. But there are one thing, when it is updated, when that is uploaded on this website, this is not given here. And what is the size of that, it is not given here. Like you have started download this and the size of this file is 5 GB, but you the GU is providing only 1.5 GB data per day. So your data, your file will be became not downloadable in the current date. So you will perform the next action next day, next action next day. So it should, if you know that this is the 5GB file, then you will think, no, I cannot download that. So you will not do that. You will read the transcript which is provided, and transcript size is not much more. When the third party content is given, this is about the YouTube. Two checkbox are there. Show the place control and show the video title and play action. So whatever which the website is automatically playing, the control should be in hand of the user. It should not be like if it is more than guideline says, if it is more than 5 seconds, then the control should be in hand of the users, so that they can stop, they can pause, they can close. If it is automatically playing continuous for 1 hour, and so it is very irritating for anyone. The image content just on the websites, whenever we are studying that and we are trying to implement that, we put this image src equal to and the link of that website which comes, and the website and the image is displayed there. What is missing there? Description is not provided. If anyone is not able to see that, what is the image that, what is the color of the image that, so the description should be given. Like you have given a BP Mandal college image on the first page of your college websites, then the description should be, this is the front gate of the BP Mandal college, this is the gate number 2 of the BP Mandal college. So it should be like that, so that the person which cannot see, they can hear that. Yes, it is mentioned there. Color contrast. Like here, you if you are using a green background, and on the color is white, so you will see like this. Can you see my mouse? So I am pointing here, like, see that the foreground is red and the background is orange. So it is saying it is a poor combination because we cannot see that. But on the red background, when we will use the white font, then it is good. It is visible. Color contrast would be chosen very wisely, so that it can perceivable by us and some other person, those are suffering from disabilities. This error generally comes that HTTP 404 not found. Why this happens? Because some pages are built, later on they move to the another web page, but no description is given. So the solution is, for that you will redirect the old page for the new one. So it will sort out that issue. And there are some issues like the fatal error, out of memory. So in that case, this problem can be resolved if you increase the memory. If from the user side SSL is incorrectly configured, then that also comes. So this is about this error. This is also happens many times. Broken links comes. Broken links should not be there. If it is there, then the proper handling should be taken care. We have done in my work, I have done a comparative study according to the 5 nations: China, UK, Russia, India, and USA. And we have visited for each country. Top 5 university I have top yes top 5 university I have taken, and based on the more than 100 features, according to these guidelines, we have assessed the website, ki is they are providing the proper implementation of accessibility or not. So you can see that the UK website is the UK website is coming with 635 score. Chinese website coming with a 515 scores. Indian is coming with 649. US is coming for 440. The higher here, the interesting is that the higher weight doesn't mean that is good website. The higher weight is showing that there are more number of defects are there. Means we have to handle more issues. So for whenever you will go for the IIT Delhi website, that is the perfect website. Perfect accessibility guidelines following GIGW, but our IIC website is not following these standards. Most of them are error, alert, feature, structural element, and missing HTML or ARIA is not used properly. So it is clear from the study that we have a lot of scope in this direction we have to do. And this is happening because of the gap between the academics and industries, or even in the industry, they are the lack of awareness about the accessibility guidelines and GIGW guidelines by the government. So there the part, the whole part one is completed. Now the second part, website securities. In this guideline, GIGW security guidelines have important features. I told you the point number 30, 31 and 32. What are these things? It should be hosted in India. Data center should be hosted in India. First thing. Data center should have a proper data recovery plan, data disasters plan. If anything happened, what should be there? Data backup plan. These should be there. These are the three things. And safe to host certificates means the website is accessible from the common security flaws. I am using the word common security flaws because the new security compromise may come. So it is for all the words, not only for us, but the common thing should be must be handled. And about data center is clear, about the security certificate is clear, and it should come with the OWASP top 10. I will tell you what the OWASP top 10. And we can issue the certificate, and the certain independent agency can also issue those certificates. So this is the basic things. I am again telling the security audit, data center here, if it is not, for data center, there are different guidelines. Then it becomes a different issue because the things are now governed by the cloud services. And for cloud services, we have the some other guidelines, how the data center should be managed, what the security password policies, privacy policy, handling policies, it becomes another exploring area. For this, we are now talking that certificate should be there. So here it is explained again, what about data center, geographically distance, location, intrusion, firewall, penetration testing, vulnerability assessment for should be completed for the websites. What should be physical and network security for the websites? How to implement all these security issues? That should be that are the part of the security compliances. This is the link of the first link is giving the certain impellent agencies. The anyone can go there. This is about the data center. It is saying that data center should be 27,001 the compliance. Either your website should be hosted in the state data center or NIC data center. First thing, if it is there, then 27,000 certificate is not required because that is already certified. And they will host your websites whenever you give them safe to host certificate, means the security clearance certificate, then they will host. But if you are not willing to host NIC server, you are due to any reason, then the data server which wherever you are hosting, that should be 27,001 compliance. This is very clear in the guideline. Otherwise that is not a safe and the violation of the security guidelines of the GIGW. Whenever anyone comes to us for the security testing, we will give them certificate, and NIC will host your website onto their server, and it will become the public. So we ask some questions. what are the our questions for that websites? What are the different roles? What are the login credentials? What is the password policy? How they are controlling the session? What are the security mechanism? What are the policy about the logs? How they are maintaining the logs? Audit trials should be present there. We will check all the things and we will start the testing. When the this is the our requirement is completed. So the user or the customer gives these things to us and we do the testing based on the OWASP top 10. OWASP top 10 means these are 10 guidelines. So these are the 10 guidelines. These are the 2017 or 2018. You will get the notice that the 2010 guidelines was this only, 2018 guideline was this only, 19 also this. But there is a change in their relative positions. Why? Because these guidelines are based on the previous year. Like for the public websites, how many number of injection attacks was taken place? It may be low in 2017, but high in 2018. Sensitive data exposure may be low in 2013, but very high in 2019. So in 2019, it will come at the top one positions. But the things are almost same, and we have to take care of all these things. For one website, we have tested and we have find this issue. From this guideline, you will find that there are more number of injection attack for this website, but we have find only 12 number of issues about the injections because people are more concerned about the injections. So these are the low. Now this is the I will explain one by one these tens. What is the meaning of this? What is the meaning of injection? What is the broken authentications? And the developer wants to tackle this, then how they can tackle that, or how to tackle that? What are the injections? Injection is like that. This is the user and this is your server. Generally, what happens? We give the SQL query to the server, and the server returns some results. But if these queries are not properly sanitized, then what will happen? The server will return the results which is not even required by the user, and the user may use it as a can handle that maliciously, or it will hamper the privacy of the other person. So this happened because of the SQL untrusted data, and the one example is given. If you, whenever you are using your Facebook, then this comes facebook.com/, then your ID will come. Random ID, it may be any number of digits, random ID will come. That is the your ID. If I will open that in my browser, it will not be login. But if that is implemented as an unsafe, like it is an unsafe query, or one is equal to one, because the if ID is matched, then return that. If ID is not matching, then also return that result. So somehow there is a very high concern about this injection attack, because it will retrieve your all the data, your email address, your date of birth, your father name, your Aadhaar number, all the things will come there. And sometimes maybe you have seen this kind of error on the whenever you are visiting any website. So this will appear. What this shows, it gives a clear picture about all the things happening in the backend. What is the database name? What are the table names? What are the fields? How many fields are there? In that field, so in that field, so what is the security is implemented? So it should not be appear as a developer. It should not never come. And how to handle that? So it can be handled by only one way: parameterize the query. Means there should be no unsafe query like this here happen, or one is equal to one, or there should be no string concatenation performed in the website. Like by the using plus sign, the string concatenation can be done. So the every query have equivalent query you have read in the database. Select star from employee. Instead of this, you can use select name from employee, select name from employee if conditions are like that. So the unsafe query or query parameterized should be done. So injection attack can be controlled. Number two, broken authentication. The meaning is that the attacker can steal your credentials, like your username and password. For Facebook, what you have only two things: your username and your password. If someone comes and steal that, then it is obviously what he can do, everyone knows. And it can be done by the random attack or brute force attack. Like I know that your user for internet banking transaction, your user ID is 456. So for this ID, I will try the random passwords. So somehow I have gained your password and user ID. And later I can perform any valid transactions. So it should not be hope. It is an example of the broken authentication, that someone has stolen your identity. How this happen? Whenever you are using a plain text, unencrypted passwords, weak passwords, missing multi-factor is not implemented. Even our Gmail is implementing the multi-factor authentication. When you open that into another browser, another system, then a message of the 6-digit will come into your mobile that are you really logging into that. So it will remind you if you are saying that even when you will enter that code, then it will provide you the login. Same thing happen with the banking transactions. The passwords which come here, even if someone get your login password, that at the time of performing the transaction, one OTP will come in your mobile. So it is that two-factor authentication. We can say it multi-factor authentication, means it can be two times, it can be three times, it can be four times, depends on the requirements. If it is financial or highly security perspective, then you have to must follow that. And this broken authentication can also done by the if the session ID which we are using that is not used correctly. You know the session ID, where the session ID are there, it is stored in the cookies. So at that time, if session ID is not proper or it is not changed, what happened when we log in into the Facebook or the Gmail or the any financial to perform the transaction, some cookies comes, some session comes, then after login that change again. If it is not changing, then it will be definitely will give you some problem to some users. And how can it be handled? Use a modern framework like the latest thing, and rewrite the application. If there is any issues there, then rewrite that. Password should be proper. HTTPS should be used. Weak password should be not used. And the thing is strengthen password reset. Like you wants to reset your password, it should not be so weak that anyone can guess. For your banking transaction, I have taken the user ID. You have lost that, I want to reset that now. I know your user ID, and I will go to the forget. And the policy is that you have to enter your date of birth or the mobile number you have. I know your mobile number. I know your date of birth. I will give that, and I will retrieve that. Getting the password was very tough, but the reset the password was very easy. So it is a serious security flaws. I hope it is good till now. The third is the sensitive data exposure. Like you have this is divided into different categories. What should be the sensitive? For financial, it is different thing, different categories. For general, there are different categories. But the some sensitive information are like the password, your credit card number, your credentials, your social security number, like your Aadhaar, your health information, your personal identifying. Why the health information is your health information is also very sensitive information. Some example of sensitive data exposure is happened by this Adobe Breeze and the Brazilian Uber in 2016. So these are some examples. They have stored all the records. Why this happened? This is happened because of only reason that the data which is stored at the server side that was not encrypted. If that is encrypted, then the problem will not come. Even if it is data is lost or downloaded by any unverified users, then he cannot read that. He cannot decrypt that. Decryption will take times. Decryption will take years. So somehow the problem can be resolved. It is the stages. If it is first give that no easy login password. You have secured that. Let's consider if anyone have guessed that random SS or anything else by your friend circle, get that. But your data is encrypted. So after one gate, there is another gate, second gate. After second gate, there is third gate. Then your data is there. Some other weakness, these are technical weakness. The developer should have taken a concern or cognizance about that what the key generation, what are the key management, whenever you send the data and there is a receiver, the sender decrypt it and the receiver encrypt sender encrypt it and the receiver decrypt it using its private keys. Or there are for security there are four things that should be implemented and they are pure technical. So the only developer is responsible for that. First was the user side, user responsibility. Second is the developer responsibility. What are the user responsibility? There should not be weak password, and the developer should not allow the weak password. That is also his responsibility. How you can mitigate from this? You classify your data into different levels. Like maybe you by getting your name, by getting your name and your email ID, no one can harm you. So this is the first level. And in the second layer, your date of birth and your mobile number is there. And the third category is your about your address. No one can reach your address. So these are the levels are created. So we should sanitize our data. Apply control. Don't store sensitive data if it is not required. You have heard about this issue using the Aarogya Setu that the government is taking too much data which is not required at all. So there are some issues which can be tackled. in different ways, up to date password, standard algorithm, protocols, huge HTTP strict transport security means the data which we are sending, that should be encrypted. It should not be only encrypted at the receiver side, like your data is going very in text format and it is going stored there. The HTTPS says that the data which you are sending from the browser or the email or anything else, that data should be encrypted also. Then it will get again encrypted at the data store side. XML entity, this is called XXE attack. What happens in the recent times, everyone is using the XML for the website developments, and the XML, you know about the XML, it is fast, easy to interpret, and there are tags are user defined. So they are the beauty of XML. But what happens if the any code is written maliciously or it is changed maliciously, then it will lead to the very very compromised results. So whenever you are writing the code, it should not have any dependencies. It should not have any dependency. Patches are should upgrade properly. Less complex data, verify your XML or the access which you are uploaded there. Maybe at one link you have uploaded another file that is going to execute. So when you are updating that file, that should be properly taken care. Otherwise it will execute on your server, and anyone if replies that, like select star from an employee, and all data will go there. One first thing, dependency, linked dependency there, it is executing on the server and the result is going there. What the malicious user will do, they will change that file. Sorry. The fifth one is the broken access control. It means the website security access controls means to put a limit what session the page visitor which can reach or what is the their need. And like whenever you order anything on the Amazon, you are the user. You cannot add any items. Like if you want to buy a laptop, you can buy a laptop. You can order that. But you cannot add there as a laptop. In the stock, there are laptops and the price is reduced. You cannot do that because that is not in your premises. If it is happening means you are gaining access of the admin. If it is allowing that, or the one admin is allowing the rights of the another admin, then it is a broken access control, and it should be accessed by hosting control, administrative panels, proper file transfer policies. It's okay. And how to prevent that? Employees should be given the least privilege. Like on Amazon, we have the least privileges. We can only just browse that. We cannot do anything else. You cannot remove the one person account, because only admin can do that. This is the admin rights, not the user rights. Audit of the server should be done. What are the activities going to take place? Is any user or any admin is doing another works? Multi-factor authentications. Remove unnecessary services which are not off your server, which is not required. To verify your applications. So these are the about the fifth. The fifth type of attack. Now the second is the security misconfiguration. It means that your network device, platform, web server, application, data, whatever you are using, they have wrongly implemented the securities. How it can be fixed? There are some technical things are there. If you are using the UDP, you know the many there are two things, TCP and UDP. Many services uses the UDP. Why they use UDP? Because that is a fast, but that is unreliable also. There is no cross rechecking. For TCP, there is cross rechecking. The sequence is maintained. For UDP, no sequence is maintained. For audio services, you are using audio video services, then you will use the UDP. You can use that. But if you for the financial transaction you are using, then you will use the TCP services. When the UDP is used, so there may be distributed denial of services attacks. You should take care. What is the meaning of that? On a web server, the random you are randomly hitting that, like on your Gmail account with your email ID, someone is hitting again and again, and using the programs, it can be hits many times in a seconds. So it is this is problem. So what they do? How to fix that? The large number of attacks can be violated by changing the default setting when installing the security misconfigurations. ठीक है? The seventh type of attack is a cross-site scripting. The first we have insert read that the XML file is changed, the linked file there are dependencies. If the one tag is depend on another is depend on another, and they are only executing after one, then five, then five are calling one is calling five is calling one. So these are the dependency. This kind of dependency was there. So now the cross-site scripting means it present in about two-third of the application. The danger is that the attacker inject content into the websites like the same things XML into the XML data is changed there. Here also content of the website is changed and modified how to display. Forcing the victim to browse victim's browser to execute a code provided by the attacker while loading the page. Means the code is changed there on the website you are browsing, that code is changed and you are executing that. It can cause hijack the user session, defame your hijack the user session means if you will click on there, your user ID and password may go there. Your identity will go there. Deface the website means he can change the content. He will change the image, image or the he will upload the audio. He will upload the video. Redirect the user to malicious sites. This happens mostly whenever you are clicking on one website and it will lead to another website. It happened many times. Whenever there are too much advertisements are there, and on that website the real code is implemented which the attacker wants to take, or attacker wants to hijack your identity, like your IP address, your MAC number. These things will shown to them, these things will go to them so that they can know your locations. Your IP address will give your locations. So, what are the strategy to mitigate that? Never insert untrusted data except in allowed locations, and sanitize the HTML markup with a library, and avoid the JavaScript URLs because JavaScript give a another problem. So you can avoid that. Avoid. We are not saying that don't use that. Avoid that. If you can have alternative, then you can. If you are using that, then properly sanitize that. insecure deserialization. You know the meaning of serialization after 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. These are kind of serialization. What is deserialization? After 1, then 5, then 4. That is the kind of deserialization. So what is happening here? The A person is sending data to B. But the E person listen that data. And the A person says, no, I am the A and I am sending to the B. So the what the B will do? B will reply to E. So it means B have to give response to A, but instead of that, the server is giving response to another person. That is the example of replay attack. So it happened due to insecure deserialization. Injection attacks can be also take place. What the E will do, it will give that incorrect query to the server B, and the B will return the results. ठीक है? And how to sanitize? How to mitigate that? What are the strategies? Not to accept the serialized object from untrusted source. For that, B know that I am in communication with A only. And how it will get know? It will use the three-way handshaking. You have read that. So by the handshaking method, handshaking is not performed by E. So B will know that no, E is not the recipient of my responses. So I will not reply to the E. Even though E is sending repeated query to B, but B will say, I have no communication with E because I don't have handshake with E. I have handshake with A only. So this is happen in the three-way handshake. So if it is implemented, then the B will know. So now hope you are able to link what you have studied. You have studied network, the three-way handshaking. Now you are using that here. Implementing integrity check of the digital signatures. E will have a different signature. E will have a different signature. The example of this is when you are using the mobile application for SBI to perform any transaction, or the Central Bank of India, Canara Bank. What they do when you install that? First, they ask the first identity that your mobile number should be registered, or the your SIM should be in that mobile that time. Even if the another user have your email ID, your user ID or password, they cannot log in. Why this is happening? This is happening by the different ways. It can be happen by two different ways. The important or the first for very simple is that the what the server will do, server will inject some key into your mobile and it will perfectly bind with your mobile, so that every time anywhere you will communicate, the server will get to know, yes, he is that person. And you cannot end up it cannot be changed. Why it cannot be changed? Whenever anything is required to change, it is again required to encrypt. So whenever if you are encrypting it again, so it will give a log and it will change the digital signature, and the server will get to know no, the digital signature is different, so no communication will take place. So these are the how to fix it. Enforce strict constraint using deserialization, and perform the integrity check. Integrity check means you are valid sender, and restrict or monitor the incoming and outgoing the network connectivity. This is the analysis part, that the server will analyze from where the data is coming. The most of the attack in recent 2 days happened. They are from the China's OnePlus. So if we know that these are the Chinese IP address, we will block them at the our server side. We have a list of IP addresses, and these IP address have a certain geographical locations. your IP address is not used in the USA. Even though we know that IP address can be given to anyone, but these are the geographically distributed. We know that these range are given to China, these range are given to USA, these range are given to India. We know that. So based on that, we will block that. The number 9 is using component with known vulnerabilities. In that, what happened that the developer don't know which open source or third party component in their system are updated. An attacker can exploit these insecure components. And how to fix that? The simplest thing is use the latest patches, use the latest software, latest updates, use them so that this kind of vulnerabilities can be removed. There is zero day attack. Zero day means the developer don't know what is the problem now the system have currently. Currently our WhatsApp, Facebook, even every application which we are using our phone have some vulnerabilities, but the attacker don't know how to exploit that. Means there is vulnerabilities we know, everyone knows, but we don't know how to use these vulnerabilities. Yannick, there is one gate we can insert from one in bank, but we don't know how to reach that gate. If we know this is the gate we can go, we don't know which key to be used to open that. Like that, this is an art and science, technology, both are there. So remove unnecessary dependencies, use common vulnerability disclosure, national vulnerability database are there, which is created by the government also or by private organizations also. Use virtual patching. So this is about the how to handle using component with known vulnerabilities. Last kind of attack is the insufficient logging and monitoring. In that, not having an efficient logging and monitoring process in place can increase a chance of website compromise. For this, the solution is there is a Skuri website security platform which monitor. I hope this is an open source or you can also use that. So it monitor that data, it monitor the floods, requests, responses, it monitors. So remote, it will remote monitor, it website a blacklist, server side scanner, DNS scanner, SSL scanner, uptime scanner. What is this is OSSEC is an open source host based intrusion detection system. Means you have implemented a website and buying any software is very costly, so there are open source concept. So this is the OSS. This is an intrusion detection system. There is one is an intrusion detection that will detect, and that is the prevention system, intrusion prevention system. They will prevent that. So it is used for the log analysis, integrity check, window registry monitoring, rootkit detection, real time alert, activity response, so that you can monitor your own website or your own server. You are ki abhi kya ho raha hai, what is happening now, what is the real time scenario, is the number of attacks are increased, low, when the number of users at what time the number of users are increasing. Like, I hope you know the example. Like between 4:30 to 6:30 in this current times, we have increases a flood of data into our the Zoom server. So you can analyze that, and at that time you can increase the memory. It can use for the different kind of analysis. And these are the different testing tools which can be used. Some are open source, Quark, Drozer, and Jet Attack Proxy. These are open source. And ImmuniWeb, this mobile suite, Kuivan, Android Eagle. These are paid basis of mobile security framework that is used for the mobile, not for websites. It can be used for the app security, website application security. So once it is completed, I told you we have the GIDW guideline are given. We are finalizing that within five minutes. Some guidelines are given. We are implementing that. We have taken as some queries from the user sites, and he have pay us for that. And we started the testing. And the testing is done based on the principle of the OWASP platform in the top 10 guidelines. So once these guidelines are satisfied, means no problem, no compromise, no error, no advice. Advice may be there, but no error. Then we will issue this certificate to them. It means this is safe to host certificate. There is no error in the website. And you can host your website to the NIC server. And NIC will not ask any more query to you. They will simply take this certificate and they will upload that. In that you can see that all the website vulnerabilities are nil. If it is anything is there present, so NIC will not going to host your websites. So what are the other things we do? I told you website application security testing we do. Mobile application security we do, vulnerability assessment and IT infrastructure, penetration testing, security process audit as per ISMS. What is the vulnerability assessment and penetration testing? They are equally, you can consider they are equally same. Vulnerability assessment is like you will run a tool, a static tool, and it will find the vulnerabilities what you have. And in penetration testing, you don't know what are the problems have. You will first do the vulnerability scan. Penetration testing is one more step. Means you will go deep inside that. How the deep? Means you get a login password. Yes, you get the login password. Then you are trying to perform the transactions. Yes, you reach there. Anyhow, you reach there. You are on that profile you have reached. How much